Blackstone Audio presents The Cliff House Strangler by Shirley Tallman. To Carol, with love always, and in memory of Kate Fleming, an enormous talent and a wonderful human being. In her performance as Anna Fields, Kate's delightful reading style created the perfect voice for Sarah Woolson in the first two audiobooks in the series. She will be sorely missed, both as a gifted reader and as a friend. Last but never least, to H.P. Chapter 1.
"I can't believe I let you talk me into this," Robert Campbell grumbled.
As if to punctuate this complaint, jagged bolts of lightning flashed across the night sky, followed by a resounding clap of thunder. That brief burst of light revealed my companion's tense face as the cabbie's frightened horse nearly ran our brougham off the road. Eddie Cooper, the young lad I'd met several months ago during the Russian Hill murders, quickly brought the dappled gray under control. Unfortunately, he seemed disinclined to lessen his horse's pace as the first heavy drops of rain splashed onto the roof of the carriage. My tall, brusque colleague, until recently one of my co-workers at the prestigious San Francisco law firm of Shepard, Shepard, McNaughton and Hall, pressed his face against the window to glare outside at what was rapidly turning into a downpour.
"I told you we were in for a storm, but no, nothing would do but that you would drag me out to Land's End in the middle of a hurricane, and for a séance of all the bizarre—"
"Oh, for the love of heaven," I sighed, fighting to retain my patience. Robert Campbell, who had proved to be a loyal ally in several past adventures, nonetheless could exhaust the fortitude of a saint. "Hurricanes occur in the tropics. This is nothing more than a rainstorm. Do stop being so melodramatic." Naturally, he ignored me.
"If your brother Samuel is so het up to write an article about ghosts and goblins, why didn't he make this ridiculous trip himself?"
"For the dozenth time, Samuel had to leave for Sacramento this morning. And as he has not as yet acquired the ability to be in two places at once, he asked me to go in his stead." I was forced to grip the seat as our carriage wheels bounced over a deep pothole, resulting in a fresh mumble of curses from my disgruntled companion. "Robert, be honest. Aren't you the least bit curious about Madame Karpova? The city has talked of little else for weeks. From what I've heard, her European tour earlier this year was a huge success." He gave a low grunt.
"I don't have any patience for gullible people who believe that this charlatan can actually communicate with the dead."
He jerked as another flash of lightning threw the bleak countryside into stark illumination.
"And why in God's name does she have to perform her parlor tricks all the way out at the Cliff House instead of some decently dry room in the city?"
He ran his fingers through his unruly mop of red hair, causing it to stick up in small, irregular patches. I also noted that his Scottish R's were rolling along nicely, becoming ever more pronounced as the storm intensified. Not wishing to encourage Robert's bad temper with a response, I silently busied myself straightening the folds of my dark lavender skirt, particularly the horizontal pleating, which had become tangled with my boots during the uneven ride. My unhappy colleague did not take the hint.
"It's a mystery to me why Junius Foster agreed to this crazy idea in the first place. Lieutenant Foster has been managing the Cliff House for 15 years, and damn profitably, too. What do you suppose possessed him to turn the place over to a Russian tea leaf reader, of all people?"
"Apparently, Madame Karpova has some very influential admirers in San Francisco society," I replied, determined not to be pulled into another one of Robert's pointless arguments. "I've never been to the Cliff House myself, but Madame Karpova evidently claims the place possesses a unique atmosphere conducive to ethereal vibrations."
"Good Lord, Sarah! Do you hear yourself?"
"Oh, do calm down, Robert. I'm merely repeating what Madame Karpova is reported to have said. I suggest you put away your preconceptions for the evening and approach the experience with an open mind." He muttered something largely unintelligible by way of a reply, then once again came an inch out of his seat when another flash of lightning lit the carriage. It was quickly followed by a clash of thunder. "Try to relax," I said, steadfastly ignoring the frayed state of my own nerves. "I'm sure this bit of weather will soon play itself out." Half an hour later, I was forced to eat these words. Not only had the bit of weather not dissipated by the time we reached our destination, it had developed into a full-fledged deluge, made worse by erratically gusting winds. Successfully negotiating the last...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.